This is The Unseen, and I'm your host, Mike Clelland. We will be talking with Elizabeth Anglin, an author who wrote the book Experience, Memoirs of an Abducted Childhood, and this was published back in 2014. This book is the story of a girl growing up in Michigan and how she tries to make sense of some very troubling experiences. The first story in the book begins, she's around 3, and it ends when she's 24. Now, it culminates with her meeting Dr. John Mack in Boston in 1990. Elizabeth was the second person to meet with Dr. Mack in his work with the UFO experiencers. So she was there very early on. This book is going to be part of a trilogy. Oh, actually, we talked a little bit about that during the interview. And that might not happen. The second and third part of what might have been a trilogy will probably be put together in one volume. And that second book will address her work with Dr. Mack over those years. So Elizabeth had like a front row seat of a very important chapter of the history of how UFO contact is being researched or has been researched, having worked with Dr. Mack. And despite some of the dark qualities of the book, this was a pretty fun interview. We both laughed a little bit. Actually laughed a lot. This interview is just a little bit over an hour long. Members get to listen to it commercial-free, the entire thing, and non-members can only listen to the first half hour, and you'll get a few commercials in there too. This interview was recorded in February of 2019. Please enjoy. Elizabeth, thank you so much for saying yes to this interview. It means a lot to me.
No problem. I'm always happy to talk to you. You're one of the best interviewers I know, so it's a joy.
Well, I haven't done this. I feel a little rusty in the interview part. The last time we talked was for my book project, and now we are talking about your book project. And your book is titled Experience, Memoirs of an Abducted Childhood. And this is the first part of a trilogy. And it takes you from about age 3 to about age 24, I think. So that's about 21 years of time that this book spans. And it tells of your youth growing up in Michigan. Now, I also grew up in Michigan, so I could tap into a lot of that, where I'm a little bit older than you, but enough that I really resonated with all the driving around and just the weather you were describing and such like that. But this was a tough story. I mean, this story has two sides of it. Some parts are very uplifting, and there's some very troubling, dark stuff here. I mean, you were talking about fears, and it feels like even in the culmination of the book, you were just barely starting to come to terms with your experiences as a 24-year-old.
Yeah, I was only waking up to them, coming to terms in terms of waking up, not coming to terms in terms of this is part of your life. This is who you are. This is your story. What is my story? Who am I? What am I doing here? Why is all of this happening? Am I crazy? Am I not crazy? Couldn't I just be normal? Couldn't I just have a normal life? Whoa, what's this new stuff that's happening now? So I am in very many ways the quintessential alien abductee that has trauma that Dr. Mack wrote about. In that you have the worldview trauma, the ontological shock of what you think is happening in the world, what you've been told all your life is happening in the world is not. And then you find out just how much of that worldview is way, way, way off of base of what reality is. Not that, you know, there aren't multiple facets of reality. It's just, there's so much more to reality, and we are just mainly in society and how we raise our kids and what we teach in schools and what we talk about in terms of religious understanding is a very, very small part of what's actually happening here.
Yeah.
Don't I know it? Yes. In fact, that's, so I feel like I've gone through that same process. I mean, for me, it felt like something needed to crumble away, and then something else needed to be reborn.
Yeah, you go through a death of your worldview in this, which is actually more painful in its own way than realizing that you've been abducted by aliens, or if you're my labs or both, you've been abducted by the military. You know, that's kind of like, oh, well, I survived that. You know, if you have a good person that works with you, you go, okay, that happened and I survived it, and you're okay with that. But your worldview crumbling away and having things happen like your relationships with people who can't go where you're going, you don't even have a capacity to step into it, even a toe, fall away. And so you have the grieving of the loss of relationships, not because they have to believe what you believe, but because they can't even go part of the way there with you. That's really hard.
Yeah, the analogy of grieving is perfect. I mean, an old life falls away and a new life is reborn, hopefully. And hopefully that new life can be a better life and a richer life. And I certainly have a different outlook on what reality means than I did at one point. It has changed in a way that I never, ever would have expected. Now here, before we get into this, you are also doing, you're an animal communicator. You do psychic readings. You do Akashic record readings and past life readings and Reiki sessions. And I mean, I look at that list there and I consider all of those sort of healing modalities.
No, they're actually very specific thought modalities. Yeah, it's how you use your mind and your consciousness. And feelings are involved because they involve clairsentience, which is clear feeling, and so clear empathy. But I've been doing medical and veterinary intuition since 1994, remote viewing since 96, 97, and spirit mediumship, and all of the sort of thought arts that require telepathy and connection with people and animals. But it's really that sixth sense and how it works with the brain, using that in a very skillful way so that I'm not just getting one little part of a message. I'm going to different levels for the physical body level, the pathophysiology level, the emotional level, the past life level, the parallel reality level. There are all these places that we exist simultaneously in the now of consciousness that end up affecting us while we're walking through the world. And so, you know, I do a lot of sort of looking around at everything now, and it's incredibly fun and rewarding, but also informative. I don't think I would trade that for much.
Now, the 23-year-old self, the 23-year-old Elizabeth that the book ends with, was this on her radar at all, these skills?
The skills were. They were in childhood, but she didn't know how psychic she was. She was, you know, her grandparents identified it, her grandfather, who didn't have that belief system, but he noticed it. My father's mother had a psychic mother, and my father was psychic, but not to the extent that I was. Like, I could walk into any test and ace it nearly. I mean, I got through honors at the 12th best public school in the U.S. by being psychic, honors courses, you know. And I look back on all the stuff I did in high school, you know, just having a jam-packed schedule and barely ever cracking a book. And the only thing I had trouble with was math, because you actually had to do it. You had to solve the problem and show your work. But otherwise, I'd just be sitting there looking at the page going, oh, yeah, that's obviously right. Oh, yeah, that's obviously right. Oh, yeah, that's obviously right. And then I get out into the rest of the world and I'm like, wait a minute, there's something wrong here. I should have studied at least a little bit, right? No, it was being in this deep, deep denial that society really forced me into. When I got older and I got out of the denial, I was like, oh, that's what claircognizance is. That's how that feels. Oh, clairsentient, that feeling I have when I'm around somebody who doesn't feel good and then I don't feel good. That's what that is. Clairsomaticism. Oh, somebody has a broken leg and I feel like I have a broken leg. Oh, that's what that is. All of these things became clear in my 20s right after I woke up and started working with Dr. Mack and meeting other people with the same skills and abilities who were also abductees.
And I want to talk a little bit about Dr. Mack, but before we go there, there was one story in the book, we talked about this briefly earlier, that I thought was so powerful and so beautiful, and I would love it if you could share that here. It was a story about, I mean, you were basically going to say goodbye to your horse, Poco.
Yes. So I had a very, this is the dark before the dawn. My mother had a lot of problems with my abductions, but she also had her own problems. I'm quite sure she was a medium who was, she was in denial of spirit in general, that there was such a thing as spirit. She was incredibly psychic herself, we found out later on, but she was just attacking me all the time. And I was 14 years old, and basically everybody was trying to find a situation where I could stay away from home. And it got to be winter, and I was just turning 14, and I had been abducted, and I had this terrible migraine that lasted for a few days. My mom was haranguing on me, and I just wanted to commit euthanasia. And my mom had kept saying, she said, telling, you know, the world you're the devil's spawn or whatever, but they don't believe in the devil, so you're every other kind of bad. I decided to euthanize myself. I decided to commit suicide. And I decided to do it in a particularly grisly way, which was to take this very large knife we had for chopping kindling and do Harry Carey and bleed out in back of the barn. But it was 20 below zero. It was January in Michigan. And I said, well, it would be very unfair of me to leave the horses out, so I will put the horses up before I do this, and my parents can find me in the morning behind the barn, frozen to the ground in a pool of blood because they suck and my life is terrible and I'm in pain. And I really want to make a statement that this is all a bunch of BS and I'm out of here. So I went to the barn with a big old knife and I went to bring the horses in. And my horse Poco, his name is Poco Johann, but it's Poco in the book. I had several horses, but he comes up and instead of walking into the stall, he stops and he puts his forehead over my heart. So where your third eye would be as a human being, he puts his forehead right on top of my heart and he knickers really low. And I just feel this upwelling of love from him, love and concern. And I'm like, telling him, oh, Joe, I'm so sorry. I'm not going to see you again. And you've been such a good horse. And the next minute, I hear this really stern voice. It didn't have a gender, saying, look at this. This horse is a better being than you are. Notice how he takes the time to stop and comfort you, even while he is in terrible pain. And I look down right around that time, and I see that his chest has been cut open. And this isn't a hallucination. This actually happened. He's comforting me, but down below, which I haven't noticed, is his chest is cut open. And it's cut open in a triangle shape in two straight lines. And the skin flap is pulled back. And rather than bleeding out, you can see the heart underneath the muscles of the chest beating where the skin flap is pulled back. And because it's so cold, all the flesh has frozen, so he hasn't bled out from the wound. All of the upper muscular flesh is frozen back together because it was just so cold. And I'm watching his heart beat in his chest. And he's just sticking his head against my heart and nickering softly and being very gentle. And then the next thing it says, you know, notice how he takes the time to stop and comfort you even while he's in pain. Notice that he has the will to survive in spite of his pain. And so to me, that was the dawn. That was the wake up. And the voice also said, you know, you've got to basically get it together because you're chosen. You're here for a purpose and you need to get on with your purpose. And I like went, you know, the kind of thing where Jenga, you know, everything falls into place. And I decided, well, I guess I won't commit suicide and euthanize myself tonight. I got to go call the vet right now. And I ran into the house and I called the vet. And the vet was absolutely perplexed when he looked at the wound because it was a perfect straight line. Everything that had been done was done with this incredible, what he called amazing surgical skill that even he couldn't do under the best of situations. And it looked like the wound had been cauterized. So even he with his tools couldn't have made such straight lines and have done such a good job opening up a chest without killing an animal. And yep, I spent the night doing, you know, hanging out with the vet and the horse and my dad.
Now there are some dark stories in this book, but this one, I mean, this story for me was really powerful. I mean, listen up, people. Listen up. This is the kind of thing that happens to experiencers. It's not just memories of waking up on a table or being taken from your bedroom at night. I mean, that's part of it, yes. But there's this other stuff, this mystical stuff. And these stories seem to play out like ancient fables or something. Now, I mean, I'm saying this partly because this has been at the core of my own research. These mystical stories, these outlying stories. And I'm at a loss to truly understand the why of it. I mean, why these things happen. People who are having UFO contact experiences tell these kind of stories. I mean, this is remarkable stuff. It's fascinating. I'm completely fascinated, but I don't understand it.
Well, there's a lot of value of life. And this is what, you know, some of the more popular horror slash alien abduction people don't get, is that there's a lot of reminding us to value our lives, reminding us to value our incarnations as human beings, reminding us to value other animals, reminding us to value our planet, reminding us to be grateful for what we have and to survive. And we as a species don't seem to be getting that message. We have been fed a lot of messages like it's not enough. You're not enough. You're not good enough. And that's what exactly the message my mother was doing. No matter what I did, I was bad and I wasn't enough. And it really took an intervention of this kind to snap me out of it and say, you are enough. It is good. You do survive. Do comfort others. Even if you're in pain, have value for your life. Have value for your connections.
It's very life-affirming. Very powerful. Yeah, I mean, the heart. I was very touched by that story. And now there was other things. Now, there's sort of a reoccurring theme within the book where people, your friends, your roommates, well, they would see things around you. And there's also like a reoccurring theme where your friends would kind of give the talk to you. They would basically say like, you know, like, I'm lonely here. You know, I come from the stars. I come from where the flying saucers are. And I'm here and I'm lonely right now. And I don't fit into this world. And that is something I've been hearing a lot from people that I talk with.
You know, I grew up in a community of experiencers and child experiencers. And, you know, we're not going to get too much into this, but one of these experiencers had a lift of everybody that he saw on ships. And he talked about them like elfin ships. And he ended up, unfortunately, passing away during an experience and getting put back. But we're not going to go into that because that could take all hour. But that list.
Well, hold on. We'll address it a little bit, and we're going to need to take a break here shortly. But we'll have to address it a little more than that. But I understand, yes, and that was a big part of the book, and I don't want to give too much away for people who will read the book. But the pool of experiencers, and this was in high school or junior high school.
High school and elementary school. We had you know, kids that I went all the way through school with, and we're still friends with in high school. And then new friends that I made in high school were all like, they were experiencers. So, yeah.
And have you talked with them recently, any of these folks?
Actually, Carrie, who she has a different name, she's also a medium now. I talked with her just before our phone call, and I talk with her several times a week, and her sister, Emma, I talk with them, and Wendy, I talk with her. She's a Facebook friend. Now, she's interesting because she's very right-wing Christian, but she's very open-minded. She's a minister's wife in Oklahoma now. So she's a big part of the book, but she doesn't, like, she won't go there. But Carrie and Emma, they totally... I was afraid. I sent them the book and I said, oh my gosh, this is going to be so terrible if you don't remember any of this. And they were like, no, I totally remember that and remember this. It was like, oh, good. Thank you. You know, and some of the people that we used to camp with and do 4-H with, you know, and the campground incident with the exploding sphere. I was like, do you guys remember this? And Ma, I forgot what I call her, but Ma Barry was like, yeah, and you were so scared. You know, and I'm like, oh, thank you, everyone.
Yeah, and this is scary stuff. This is scary stuff. Hey, I'm going to have to interrupt. We're going to have to take our first break. We'll be right back. For members, keep listening.
This is Whitley Strieber. I'll be at Contact in the Desert this year from May the 31st through June the 2nd. I'll be talking about first UFOs and then a lecture on Alien Contact, A Miracle Denied, discussing excerpts from my new book, which is the first book I've written about this in a long, long time. Plus, Eric Von Daniken will be there, Graham Hancock, Linda Moulton Howe, popular Dreamland guests like Peter Lavenda will be there. It's going to be an exciting conference. It's in a beautiful hotel, the Renaissance Hotel, in Indian Wells, California. That's May the 31st, June the 3rd. Go to contactinthedesert.com to find out more.
Welcome back to The Unseen. I'm with my guest, Elizabeth Anglin, and we're talking about her book, the first part of a trilogy of books, titled Experience, Memoirs of an Abducted Childhood. Just before the break, we touched on one of the more unnerving and frightening parts of the book. I mean, I did not expect it. Like, when that happened, I was thunderstruck reading the book. I did not expect it. But there was a fatality of someone in your high school circle, or actually it was the way it sounded, was outside your circle, but there was a fatality of someone in your high school. And if you could talk about that.
Well, yeah, he was outside my circle because the moment he got in my circle, he recognized me from experiences. And so we were both in this gifted after school program in junior high. And the first year I was in it, I think I was the only girl in it. And then they let in more students the second year, and he came in, he was a year younger, and he came in with that group, and he would run around staring at me saying, I've seen you naked on the ship, remember? I've seen you naked. And I was like, this guy's nuts, and he keeps staring at me, and he keeps telling people he's seen me naked, and this is all sorts of bad, and I got to get out of here. So I left the gifted after school program, and I never talked to him because he was a nutcase. And then he became friends with Emma. And he was very good. He and she were best buddies. They weren't girlfriend and boyfriend, but they were best buddies. And they did gaming. He did, and she did, but not, you know, at that time in Michigan, there had been a Dungeons and Dragons case, but there was nothing like that. But he and she used to talk about his dreams and what was happening with the elves who came on ships who were trying to save the earth. Well, he ended up being killed, and I think he died because he was learning how to break the mind control, and he happened to move the wrong way during a procedure, and he ended up with a hole in his head, and he was put back in his room naked on his bedroom floor with this hole in his head that was completely cauterized and there was no blood. Well, at that point, his dad, who was a sheriff's member, sheriff's deputy, freaked out. It went all the way to the top of the town politics, freaking out because you've got a kid at home in a sheriff's deputy's house with no gun, no knife in his room, all the doors and windows locked, naked and dead with this very unusual wound in his head. And a list of dreams and other kids that he's seen in these, in what he's written down in his journals and his diary. And so they put those of us he wrote about on watch because they were trying to figure out if he had been involved with drugs. Of course he wasn't. And if somebody was going to try to kill us. And it was a big quiet for anybody who was on the outside brouhaha in the town. And what ended up happening is, you know, I was talking just at the same time, somebody tried to convince Emma to kill herself because she knew too much. And she was getting phone calls telling her to, you know, that she should kill herself. And for whatever reason, this voice on the phone, which was kind of non-gender and a little bit electronic, had this hold on her. She kept picking up the phone and listening to it. And I was about to do my homework and I heard a voice in my head, sort of like the one that told me to get it together, saying, call Emma right now. And so I picked up my phone. I called her and I said, hey, Emma. She's like, yeah. And it was like a really, you know, there was a pregnant pause. Yeah. And I said, what are you doing? And she just blurted out, I'm holding a gun to my head and I'm about to kill myself. And I said, well, don't do that. You know, that's a bad thing, you know? And so we ended up talking, you know, pretty in hanging out for the next week. Well, in the course of talking and hanging out for the next week, we were both abducted from her house and her dad was the assistant attorney general for the town. And he was on high alert because he had all the ins and outs of the case of this boy who had just died. And it, you know, they told people it was a suicide. It wasn't a suicide. Everybody who saw the situation knew it wasn't a suicide. Well, he had all the ins and outs and he was on high alert because Emma was all over the writing and I was too. So they had this big basement with a semicircular couch that fit two people end to end. And we go down there to go to sleep. And shortly after we go to sleep, he sees lights on the lawn, hears noises in the house, gets up to check it out, and we're gone. And he goes to look for us outside. He goes to look for us everywhere. He ends up calling the police because he thinks, oh, my God, they've been abducted and they're going to be killed. And, you know, we wake up in the morning and we're both on the couch. And the next thing we know, we're being treated to this amazing breakfast and everybody looking at us like, you know, on bated breath and him asking me a series of questions about what happened the night before about what happened while we were sleeping. And I'm going, I don't know, you know, we were asleep. So, and then I get a phone call at breakfast from my dad who says, come home now. And then I come to find out that there have been basically guys who said they were in the FBI but weren't came and they took my journals and my writings. And there was this big brouhaha. And so all of this happened and it was never really explained, you know, what happened. It was just a really scary, frightening, dark, bizarre situation. There's more to it. And then it went away. Basically, you know, prayed with a friend about it. And for me, it basically seemed to just go away. And then I went on with my life.
And that was one of the other very touching moments of the book, the prayer was your friend's mother?
My friend's mother was into A Course in Miracles, but she was also Catholic. And, you know, I was Protestant. And Catholics, prayer is different. Prayer is divine intervention. It's miraculous. And Course in Miracles, prayer is miraculous. And so she and I prayed to get me out of the situation, to make sure that I was safe and not threatened. And I woke up in the morning after that prayer and I knew I was fine, that nothing bad was going to happen to me. So it was, you know, a lot of this, if you have a spirituality, it becomes stronger because you see, feel, hear, and know you're okay. You're going to be all right. You can be in a place of deep, deep fear and paranoia and and terribleness, and then all of a sudden, spirit, for lack of a better word, can lift you out of it. And that's also in the book.
And the all of that stuff is remarkable, those all those stories. And I have to give you a lot of credit, the writing, the way you wrote it and the way it unfolded. I mean, it was sort of like a teen drama on one sense, and at the same time, it was genuinely unsettling. I was shocked at the number of experiences you had.
Yeah, and that's not all. I mean, that's maybe 55%. I mean, and somebody complained on Amazon that too many things happened. This can't be true. And I'm like, oh God, you know, and that's holding back, you know. So,
well, I worked on a project, and I had to interview a lot of folks for this book project. And that was what I found. I mean, how to say this, doing this work. I mean, you must understand what I'm saying here. Doing this work means having phone calls, and those phone calls are 7 hours long, and you're just barely scratching the surface when you talk to people about their experiences. Now that you say that, that doesn't surprise me, but there's a wealth of stuff going on in this book.
Well, I was going to say, you know, you didn't want to talk too much about Dr. Mack, but what we found out in the next book is he was someone who was willing to sit for hours and listen to each and every experiencer who came across his path. He would do long sessions of just listening and recording and taking notes, you know, 3-4 hours. He would do long sessions, long regressions, not, oh, we've got an hour and a half, okay. And, you know, you just get into it and then he takes you out. No, he'd wait till you were done and he'd say, look, you're really strong. You survived it. You're still here. You know, and that's something you need to hear at the end of an experience. Look, you're going to be okay. Why? Because you survived all that. And you did it again. And you did it again. And you're all right, and you're in school, and you're functioning highly, and you've got, you know, you've got all this other stuff going for you. So, but he took the time to get to, you know, what he talked about with people was scratching the surface, but what he actually did was go really far beneath it, because he was willing to sit and not just do 1 4-hour interview, but 12, you know.
I do know. Yeah. I'm not a clinician. I'm not a therapist, but I do know. And that is, and it was for me when I was working on the book project, it was very cathartic for me to sit and listen to these folks and really be present and recording these things and transcribing some of the stuff. So you worked with Dr. Mack for how long?
7 years. And we were still friends when he died. But I stopped getting regressions, I think, in either August or September of 97. And I started working with him. And, I first talked to him in January of 1990 and got my first regression in August of 1990.
We are going to have to take our second break. For members, stay here. We'll be right back. For non-members, thank you so much. The first half hour will be ending and we're just about to start the next half hour.
UnknownCountry.com offers daily news of the edge of science and reality. Stories you just won't find anywhere else. Plus, a huge archive of Dreamland and our other shows. Rarities, like Whitley Strieber's original hypnosis sessions. A free newsletter. Weekly chats with Whitley Strieber. Whitley and Ann Strieber's provocative blogs. UnknownCountry.com. Visit us every day.
We are back with The Unseen. My guest is Elizabeth Anglin, and we are talking about her book, Experience, Memoirs of an Abducted Childhood, part of a trilogy. Now, the book, your book ends, the last chapter is pretty much meeting Dr. Mack. And that I love something that he said. He said something in your initial phone call, and you were very funny the way you said, he asked, do you see this as a shamanic experience? And it was very funny how you answered it, because I don't think I would have known what shamanic experience was when I was, whatever, 23 or so.
Yeah, I didn't have an idea what he was talking about. I forgot how I answered it, but I kind of was like, oh, crap, say something that sounds like you know what you're talking about. Yeah. What do you think? Long, pregnant, past due, needing to be induced, paused. Shamanic. So, what the hell does he mean by shamanic? I mean, that was, my brain was just going, oh, crap. I'm in a conversation with somebody who knows words I don't.
So this is like getting close to over 25 years ago, that conversation. How would you answer that question now?
Well, at that time I said, possibly, you know.
Well, how would you answer it now?
Absolutely. Abso-freaking-lutely. Yeah.
Well, so why would you say that? Now, I'm curious. Now, I'm going to just jump in. Like, I was trying to keep a little list of all the animals you ran into in the book. Like, there were rabbits and owls and a fox. There's an amazing story with a fox. You even have, what seems to be almost like a... I mean, back to the shaman thing, it sounds like a shamanic journey of sorts. It was almost this dream realm with a pegamoose, like a half pegasus, half moose with a flying snake and a lot of animals. And now I'm going to ask you, why? You say absolutely, this was a shamanic experience. Why do you feel that way?
Well, I feel that way because, you know, the most important messages and experiences are couched, like the experience with the horse, of having the heart. Horses are great for heart. The shamanic energy medicine of horse is heart. It's about having the heart and the will to endure. All of that is part of that. And then birds, I have such a relationship with animals. I always have. And, to the extent that I felt bad because other people didn't get animals. You know, animals were always talking to me, whether or not I realized they were directly talking to me and showing me things and informing me. But shamanism is also, it's about our connections with everything that is. It's about our connection through spirit in the oneness of everything that is. And that's shamanic.
And I'm very cautious to sum up with shamanism or what's shamanic with a quick little two-sentence definition, because I think it's very personal. It's like saying, you know, like, what is spirituality? You know, it's got that open-ended quality to it.
Well, it's the way of, you know, shamanism is taught, whether it's modern shamanism, you know, you do develop these skills. You develop the ability to see other dimensions, to find out the spiritual, psycho-spiritual sources of illness. You listen to messages from the universe through animals or for totem animals. Now, we didn't have, if I had been Native American, I would have had a culture with which to couch these experiences within, and didn't. And so they were just weird things that happened with animals, you know, because no, I didn't come from that culture.
Now, the way we met was I was working on a book on owls, and you had a couple of owl stories that I loved. And one of them, which you talked about briefly, this is going back a few years or no, did you have little owls like that you could hold in your yard that would let you hold them?
They wouldn't. No, I didn't hold them a lot, but I could go up to them. I could hang out with them. And some of them would, there was one behind the barn and there was one in the apple orchard. So little, yeah, two, when you say owls, plural, little, yes, they were probably northern saw-whet owls. But one might have been what's called an elf owl, which was the one behind the barn. I think he was some, but I haven't found anything called an elf owl. I think that might have been a euphemism or something. But this little elf owl behind the barn, I spent a few days with him. And I think he was quite young and he just wanted a buddy. But and then there was a pygmy saw-whet owl that I visited with in the apple orchard. But they liked the apple trees. The apple trees were old. It was an old farm and the neighbor's orchard was old. But I would spend a lot of time developing that here, wild thing, don't be afraid of me connection. I mean, I was the kid who was waiting for the ducks to befriend me and they would always fly off just before I got to them. And I would spend hours trying to get birds to befriend me. So this wasn't like I'm you said Snow White and it's like, no, this is, I'm really motivated, you know.
I said Snow White in a in one of our chat box things.
I mean, you know, everybody else is going to be inside watching Godzilla and I'm out, you know, befriending owls and spending time on it. So, but that's me, you know, I liked tadpoles and I liked bugs. I mean, I used to spend hours and hours just outside looking at everything that was alive.
I'm going to jump to Dr. Mack a little bit, and this touches more to what will be coming out in the second book. Now, here I have to ask, when is the second book due out?
2 years ago.
So, in my opinion, you're ahead of schedule then if you're only 2 years late. So,
2 years. I'm only 2 years late. So the second book is actually now going to be the second and third book because so many people have yelled at me for separating the books up and not being done with the second book. So it was going to be three books, but it's going to kind of be two books in one. So the second book is Inquiry. It's about working with Dr. Mack. And the third book was about a rescue mission, but we thought it was a rescue and retrieval mission, so we would have proof, because at one point in the second book, Dr. David Pritchard at MIT had said to me personally, and then to everybody else, you know, the only proof that's going to fit is going to be if you find a crash disk that still functions with a dead alien inside. Well, that was arranged, but it was 80 foot down in the bottom of a lake. And the first group of experiencers and I went for it. It didn't work out the way we expected. But so that's the third book. But the second book is really about working with Dr. Mack and overcoming the trauma and going through the Harvard inquiry and, you know, meeting Dave Pritchard and having an implant that now we could look at and say, wow, that was made out of carbon 13, and it was rolled, and it had this interesting braided structure.
Oh, let's just back up a little bit. So let's talk a lot about this implant then. So this is from you?
This is from me, and I ended up, it was the night after an experience, and we didn't have to remove it. It came out on its own, and Dr. Mack took it to Dave Pritchard at MIT because he had said he'd be interested if there was anything physical that came up, and this implant came up. And Dave Pritchard, he's an optics physicist, and he's not a Nobel Prize winner, but his student Wolfgang Ketterle is, and they worked on the same project together. So anyway, he said he'd be interested in that, and Dr. Mack gave it to him. And he ended up sending it to the universe.
Oh, here, I'm gonna back up a little bit. Can you describe it? I mean, when you say an implant,
It was a red wire that came out of the area in the corner, you know, in the corner of your eye, if you touch the bridge of your nose where it hits your brow, your mm-hmm. brow bone, it came out of the left side of that area and caused a tremendous headache. What happened is I went through an experience. I hadn't put it in right, so it basically fell out on its own coming down the back. This is gross, but, you know, coming down the drainage in the back and into my mouth and with a big glob of goo.
Oh, that is kind of gross. Okay.
It was significantly painful and gross, but nobody had to cut into me to get it out.
Now here, let me interrupt again. Was it orchestrated? So you could hand it to a scientist at MIT.
I'm quite sure it was orchestrated so I could hand it to a scientist at MIT so that we could get scientists involved, because I was working with a group of aliens that wanted disclosure, and they wanted disclosure, you know, 10 years ago. And as far as they were concerned, there had been an agreement that either the U.S. or Russia were going to do disclosure, and neither of them were getting on it. And so all of a sudden, a bunch of In my understanding, and from talking to people that I know, a bunch of us were woken up at the same time in order to do disclosure. And so, oh, you need this? Okay, we want to get scientists involved. You know, we want to give them just enough information so that they'll start looking into it and finding out about it and sort of cracking open that door without too much freak out. Yeah, okay, we'll help. And that's what we were there to do. That's the reason I came here. That's what I was here for. So, and that's what the aliens were doing. So yeah, it was totally orchestrated. Who woke up? Orchestrated. All of it was orchestrated.
What about your book?
Oh yeah, I was supposed to write. I mean, I was always a good writer. I won a Detroit News, you know, honorable mentions, and I won awards as a kid as a writer, and my teachers would look at me and say, you're going to write. You know, I didn't have to take any English in college. I went directly to 400 novel writing courses. So yeah, all of it. Me being a writer. Yeah, all of it.
So Dr. Mack, I've met a handful of folks who have worked with Dr. Mack, and I've been extremely impressed with the, you know, the people who had worked with him. I guess I'm saddened beyond words that we lost him. And I'm looking forward to reading the second book, just to hear the interactions between you and Dr. Mack. Now, if I'm not mistaken, you were one of, if not the first, you were the second person to actually contact Dr. Mack?
Well, I was put in contact with him. So Bud Hopkins put us in contact. The only reason I'd say I'm the second is because he saw Julia first, and then he saw me second when he was ready to start working with us. And he did her regression a few days before mine. But Julia and I had known each other from childhood. And according to her husband and people who knew her when we were young, we basically could have been clones or twins. And we might be clones. We might be physical clones of each other. But we don't talk about that. But I'm talking about it on air because her husband saw me and she saw me and they both went, oh, and she remembered me from kids, but we never directly said, yeah, you're my clone, you know, but basically there's something to that going on.
So that was the other person that was?
That was the other person. She's 11 years older than me. And apparently we looked so similar at my age at 24 that her husband nearly fell over and fainted.
This is remarkable to me. Now, I use this analogy all the time. Like if I was a science fiction writer and I was writing this, or if I was like writing for the X-Files and I wrote this into a plot, you know, the producer would have every right to come into the script writing room and kind of go, a little too corny. That's a little over the top, you know, rein it in.
Yeah. But you know, given what was going on, we were both in the hybrid program. My father was in the hybrid program. I think she was actually my father's daughter. I don't know if we were clones, but I think we were basically siblings of some sort. So however you want to put that, because she looks like my dad too. You know, her dad's my dad too.
And is that her sense? Are you still in touch with her?
I don't talk to her now, but that was her sense at the time, was that there was a deeper familial connection that, and she was very kind to me, and you know, her husband would swear on it. He would swear we were twins. So, you know, take from it what you will. That's how I'll write the book, which is watch that guy's face, watch him lose it, you know?
Yeah.
Which is, I don't feel like I'm her. I don't feel like, you know, she's definitely her own person. Her reaction to all of this was different than mine. I got a lot more trauma out of it than she did. She was like, oh, they're not taking my babies. Those are her babies. I'm like, they're mine. You know, how dare they? So we had very different reactions to things.
You're throwing a lot of stuff in the soup here. I'm shocked at how much is coming out of just this 1 hour talk here. There's a story you told. This has to do with an owl, and I fully realize that I can't sidetrack too much of these things and get into the owl talk, but this is another remarkably beautiful story about the very first experiencer support group meeting that Dr. Mack had at his home. And could you talk about that?
Sure. It was Julia and her husband and Dave Duclos, who's passed away, Steve Walsky, who's passed away, so I feel I can mention his name, and their friend. And Dave and Steve had been in a group abduction experience up at a lake in northern New Hampshire. Julia was, again, somebody who had the first regression with Dr. Mack. I was the second. And the friend was basically, he hadn't been there at the experience, but he just wanted to hang out with his friend. So we're all in this, you know, the first ever support group meeting, and people are talking about a lot of beeping and a lot of weird sounds before experiences and weird physical feelings and vibrations and humming noises and all of that sort of initial, you know, something's coming because you hear the hum or you hear the beep or you hear the 40 cycle washer, you know, whatever. So one of the guys, Dave Duclos, was 6'4". He had a facial tic and he had a stutter. And his affect, his personal affect and his size and his imposingness was so frightening that as we were leaving, he tried to give me a bear hug and I was like, ugh! You know, and we leave and Julia and her husband are giving me a ride back to the train station because I'm going to take the train to Somerville where I was living. And they give me a ride. And while we're in the car, as we're getting in the car, her, Julia's husband said, wow, you know, what do you think? Because Dr. Mack mentioned that we were part of a club now, that we were all in the club. And Julia's husband said, wow, you know, what do you think about being in that club? And I said, the last person we had seen was Dave. And I said, I don't want to be a member of any club that he's a part of because he scares the crap out of me. And as we're driving down the road away from the house, just after I say this about the club and not wanting to be a part of any club that that guy's a part of, this snowy owl flies over the top of the car and basically glides in front of the car down the road in front of us, you know, right over the hood for, we don't, it seemed like an eternity, but it was probably just a second or two or three. And we're watching this, you know, 8-foot wingspan snowy owl gliding over the hood of the car in front of us. And then it peels off to the right into woods that are off to the right. But it was right after I said, I don't want to be a part of any club that that guy's a member of. And Dave Duclos ended up being my very, very, very best friend in all the world in the course of all of this. So it was like prophetic and, you know, oh, you think you're not going to be part of a club? Look at this. You know, it's going to be a great club. But we didn't know that at the time. But the just the beauty of the moment, it was like everything stopped. So I couldn't forget that I said it, because the second after I said it, there was this huge snowy owl flying over the car.
It's when I sort of try to unpack that story, the way I visualize it is that the owl is on Dr. Mack's house waiting for you to leave. That's, I have no way to prove it, but that's the way it feels. So,
you know, a lot of stuff happened at that house, which I'll get into some of it, but for, you know, by the time it was over, and during the course of all of this, Sally Mack and John Mack divorced. And some were saying that she couldn't handle the stress of everything that was happening at the house, and things that are not my story to tell, so I'll just sort of lightly touch on them in the book and here, was that there were flashes of light, there were voices, there were things that were happening after and during support group and during sessions that got way far into the mystical slash paranormal slash what the F is that?
Now, this is the first time I've heard this. Now, it does not surprise me in the slightest, and I actually almost expect this. So you're saying that there were, let's say, poltergeist mystical experiences in Dr. Mack's house, and that's, he was using his own home for treatment, wasn't he? An office?
He didn't have an office. It was his long-gone son's bedroom. And he wasn't ever alone with some, you know, experiencers in a bedroom. And any of this stuff that you might say about anybody else being involved with experiencers as a researcher did not apply to him in any way. Pam Casey was always there. This is at the very beginning. There wasn't an office. There wasn't a place to go. And it's a comfortable home. It's a big home. And he had a nice, great room to have support group meetings in. And when we got over 36 people, we had to find our own place to go. But, you know, initially it was just, you know, 5, 6, 7 of us, and it was no problem. But yeah, he was doing the work in his own home because there wasn't another place. But it was also, it was a good place. It was a good, solid house. It felt like a safe place. But I don't think it felt very safe to Sally after a while. Now, other things went on, but, you know, but my understanding was it was hard on her, everything that was happening at the house. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it is her home, too.
Yeah. And now, so here's a question about hypnosis. As far as coming to terms with your experiences and the new information that arose through hypnosis, how would you weight the hypnotic experience, your hypnosis experiences, as far as part of your therapy with Dr. Mack?
Really, really awesome. And I went to somebody else before him, and she bungled the crap out of it. And she really left me in a bad place because she got scared. When the scary part came, she got scared and pulled me out. And I was way tougher than she was. I was way ready to handle the scary part. And yeah. and so she left me in a state of half-doneness. I was the half-baked potato walking around having flashbacks the rest of the week of the scary part, not knowing what happened, which is, you know, not knowing what happened when it's something scary is worse than knowing what happened and knowing you got through it. Dr. Mack would take you all the way through what was happening, and he would ask the right questions to make it not just traumatic, but also make it positive. He was asking the right kinds of questions, but also reinforcing the right understanding. Look, you've been through it and you've already survived it. You can do this and you can get through this.
Oh, and what would you say to someone who has like a strong opinion about hypnosis and feels it should not be used in UFO research?
Certain people shouldn't be doing hypnosis. They're leading people. They are reinforcing their own spiritual and religious belief system. They're working off of a storyline. They're implanting memories. Unless you are a high caliber person who knows how not to lead, how not to implant, either even to suggest under hypnosis your own belief systems, your own storyline, you shouldn't be doing hypnosis. And there are too many people who are doing that these days. And I've met experiencers that I know that I've been experiences with who have had storylines implanted, and I'm peeved as crap about it, but I can't do anything about it.
Storylines implanted by a hypnotherapist?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
They've gone so far down a rabbit hole that is somebody else's storyline. I can't even justify that. All I can do is go, because it's wrong. And having researchers who tell experiencers what to think, oh, you're just a victim and they're bad and they're trying to take over the world and you just think you're not a victim, you know, that kind of stuff too. That's wrong. There's all sorts of ethical wrongness that can happen that we were actually trying to prevent back in the day. And now it has happened and there it is. And so, but regression for experiencers when done correctly is awesome, you know, so.
Okay.
You know,
yeah.
It's a double. So it's both light and dark. It's wonderful, but when it's done correctly.
And I ask because I've had my own experiences with hypnosis, and I've tried it a handful of times. Nothing new came up. I basically told the exact same story that I remembered consciously, and I guess the issue is that. People actually don't have a definition of what hypnosis is. I mean, we're dabbling with something that's very mysterious, and I am very cautious. Yes, I think some stuff that shows up could very well be true, and other stuff, and I just feel like it has to be treated very cautiously, the whole process.
Well, the whole process has to be treated very ethically and very cautiously. But the other thing is, when you have screen memories, if you don't get through the screen memory, you can go down, you can jump to a conclusion about a storyline. The other thing is, look, John Mack was a trauma psychiatrist. He was a child trauma psychiatrist. He knew what people's affects were when they had trauma. He knew how to listen to people. He knew how to hear and get a sense of a kinetic feel from them that they were touching on their actual trauma. Trauma is in the body. The body doesn't lie. And he knew from watching affects over years of trauma patients where the trauma was, and the truthiness of it. There's a word he used, verisimilitude, something like that.
See, he loves big words.
He loves big words. But the truthiness, he would explain that as the truthiness of it. And other people wanted to discredit him for his knowledge base of truthiness in terms of affect, in terms of trauma. No, this was a guy who knew what trauma looked like, smelled like, sounded like, you know, and when it was true and when it was just, I want to whine and I want someone to listen to me, you know, and so I'm going to make up a story. He could tell in 2 seconds if you were BSing about your pain and whether it was a true pain and a traumatic pain or just you having a bad day. And he had no time for you having a bad day. You know, he'd get to the end of your bad day in 2 seconds with psychiatric technique. Okay, finish next. What do you want to work on? You know, so, but a lot of people are out there now doing things that have to do with that's religious cultism. And we were warned about that. There was a gentleman who spoke at the MIT conference. He said, you really have to be careful that this doesn't become a religious or a healing cult, because it's so possible for this to happen. And I'm looking at what's going on now and I'm like, wow. And spirituality, being a spiritualist, isn't necessarily being a cultist. It's having a worldview that's different. But when you attach that to a storyline or different storylines that have to do with a religion, then you're getting, and you have certain people who are in control of that information, then you're getting into a cult-like situation that's not good.
So you were at the Alien Abduction Studies Conference at MIT, and that would have been in the late 1990s, correct?
Yeah, early 1990s.
Oh, early. Oh, my word. That's right. It would have been that much earlier. And what was that conference like?
There were all of the researchers that they could possibly get in one room presenting a talk like you do at an academic conference, and some experiencers, myself included, and some therapists / researchers, and Dave Pritchard, who used his ability to use MIT facilities and his name to get the word out there, and his wife Andy, and John Mack, and A.C. SETI person, and Bud Hopkins, and then just a bunch of other researchers, a PsyCop guy who said it was all a witch hunt, Baker, I think was his name. But Barbara Lamb, all sorts of people were there.
Wow, sounds remarkable.
Yeah, I don't know how in-depth you want to go, but, we went over the abduction experience, we went over evidence, we went over psychology of abductees, people's hypotheses, ethics and therapy and investigation, and, what should be considered next. And then after that happened, like, everything just went kaput, and it's like the field, because there was such an attack on Dr. Mack, everybody ran for the hills, basically. Because in 94, when his book came out, he really got attacked. But as of 1992, he wasn't really attacked by Carl Sagan or in the media or anything like that. So everybody was very hopeful at that point. It was all very hopeful.
The research got stunted, though the experiences, kept on happening. Yeah, that's a dark chapter, and I know there's some talk of making a movie about Dr. Mack's life, and I hope that happens, and I hope it happens in a way that's respectful, and because it's a dynamic, engaging, drama, his story.
Yeah.
Hey, this has been great. I want to thank you so much, and I will follow up when the next book comes out.
Yes, that would be wonderful. I loved speaking with you, and thank you so much for having me on the podcast.
You're very welcome. You're very welcome. It's been a delight. This is Mike. I am chiming in at the end. Hey, you know what I forgot to do? I never did the thing that you're supposed to do at the end of an interview like this. I never asked Elizabeth, how do people get a hold of you? So I'm going to put it here. So if you want to find out more, you can go to ElizabethAnglin.com, and the last name is spelled A-N-G-L-I-N, ElizabethAnglin.com. You can get her book on Amazon. The title is Experience. The subtitle is Memoirs of an Abducted Childhood. And on her site, right across the top banner, it says Psychic, Spirit Medium, and Animal Communicator. And we've had some private conversations about her animal communication stuff. It's quite fascinating. I apologize. We really couldn't get into that in the interview here. Her book is excellent, and I'm really looking forward to part 2 and part 3. And when those come out, I would love to talk to her again and do another formal interview. Oh, and one more thing. I need to thank Lauren Cutts for the eerie music you heard at the beginning and again here at the end. He mixed that, and it features Andrea Villiere on the gong. And if you've made it this far, thank you so much. Bye now.